Hi, Marilyn. Welcome to Movie Junk. How are you?
I'm really excited. How are you?
I'm excited too. I'm excited. It's such a pleasure to have you on today. We have the extremely talented actress Marilyn Uribe joining us, and who fans from the Narcos Mexico show know you as Alicia.
And exactly.
You've made several, you know, guest appearances on hit shows, also a Netflix show, Yankee, and the Romanoffs. If I'm not mistaken, that was also created by Matt Wiener, who's famous from Mad Men and The Sopranos. So I can't thank you enough for joining us today.
No, thank you for inviting me, and I'm really excited. This is like my first interview in English for this season.
Oh, this is awesome. I'm honored to obviously be the first. And it's funny, I mean, I was literally just, you know, finishing the last season of Narcos Mexico and just saw you on TV, and it's an honor to have you on. So it's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, this is the last season for Narcos Mexico, and we are really, everyone in the show, we're really excited to do this last season and actually end it on the Arellanos Felix family. So I'm in it, and Bonnie is there. So it's a huge crew, a lot of such a great actors, and we have the opportunity to be directed by Wagner Moura, who is Pablo Escobar in Narcos Colombia. So it was just an amazing experience being there.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned, you know, Bad Bunny joined this season, and last season, wasn't it Fuego that joined?
Yeah, Cuervo was there.
Yeah, I mean, you guys are getting some amazing artists to join the show.
Actually, I think that Narcos has been a really big show. There's a lot of people outside of Mexico, since it's kind of like a hard topic to talk about it. And here they do a lot of shows about Narcos and about this reality that we live in Mexico City since, I don't know, like 20, 30 years ago, that it's really hard for the Mexican people to kind of like understand. So, but outside of Mexico, it's huge, like in Europe and especially in United States. And it has caught the attention of big artists like Cuervo or Bad Bunny, that they want to be there. Like Snoop Dogg is a huge fan of the show. So I love hip hop. I was amazed when I knew that Cuervo was coming to shoot on season two. And then we saw a Snoop Dogg posting that he was watching the show. So for me, it was like a fan moment.
That's amazing. Are there any funny Fuego stories you could share with us?
Yeah, it's a plenty, especially with Cuervo. Like he came out with all his crew, everyone was like partying, and we were doing this scene where he's trying to make crack. So wow. He did like a 20 shots on that. It was really easy to work with him. He's very chill, and all his crew was amazing. Like his team was amazing. But with Bad Bunny, what's a different story? He was so focused in the scenes, and we were shooting the second episode that it's like the wedding of my sister and Medina. And it took like almost 4 days, I think, but night, it was like a whole night. And he was just a hardworking person. Like he took it so seriously and very humble. He's not like, hey, I'm Bad Bunny. He came like, hola, I'm Benito. So it changed the mood on the scene, you know, because he came after he did the Super Bowl with Jennifer Lopez. So he was huge in that moment. I mean, he's huge now, but in that moment, he was like huge, like Bad Bunny is coming to the show. So yeah, it's different. The experience working with them, it's totally different, but it was so much fun and learning a lot from them.
Yeah, that Super Bowl halftime show is probably my favorite halftime show, you know, with J-Lo and Shakira. I mean, that show was awesome. I'm a 49er fan, so the game didn't go the way we wanted it to be, but the halftime show was the best.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, Bad Bunny was awesome, and I noticed him right away, and he was so good. It's like he'd been on the show since the beginning. I mean, you can easily say he's a phenomenal actor. He was great on the show.
Yeah, he's kind of like a natural, and I think it's part of being him, like a performer person, you know, like he's doing a lot of shows in front of the people, but different, it's kind of like different, but he felt like very natural. And actually he was playing a character from Tijuana, where I'm from. Yeah. And yeah, he did like a really work. He worked a lot in his accent, and he, you can kind of like notice that he's from Puerto Rico, but also he did a lot of work on his accent. So I think his character, it's so good in the show. So I'm really happy that we have him.
Yeah. And you mentioned, so you're originally from Tijuana, and your family, obviously it's part of the Tijuana cartel, and you're playing a real character. I mean, what type of research did you have to do? I mean, like, what kind of prep did you have to do in order to take on this role?
Well, actually it was like very, because my first casting that I did, I think it was in the end of 2018, or I think so, like long time ago. And I was casting for Güero Palma's wife, and then they changed it eventually to tell me to do it in a Yano Felix sister. And yeah, it was like very shocking since I'm from Tijuana and that's the story of my city. And you know, I read a lot about the family, but also I lived there, so I kind of like understood where the all this the family came from, and how it affect the city and the family. So it was kind of like a hard work to put like my mind through the building a character and not judging the character and being someone that had listened and being like seeing all this bad sides of narcos there in my city. So it was kind of like shocking. And one of the things that I really remember when the second season came out, I was really excited, like posting and stuff. And I used to have like a video show. I was a TV host in Tijuana for a video game show. So a lot of people know me there. And they knew that I was in the show, and they were really, really hard on me. Like, how come you're like excited and happy to talk about your city in that way? And it was like very shocking because it was a huge project. I mean, Narcos is a huge project for me. It was a big opportunity as an actress. And like all the time they took me to be there, like I went to LA from Mexico City. I went to LA to do the casting and then wait like 2 months, and all my journey to go in and being cast in this big show. And after all my work and my excitement, noticing that the people still like, I mean, people still heard about the story of the Arellano Felix, and it's, I don't support any type of this culture, you know, like narcocultura, of course not, but I can totally understand why people react like that, especially because I'm from there. And also for me to try to understand that, you know, as an actress, you have to tell the story that they're giving you. And unfortunately, that's the reality of my city, and I cannot erase that. It's very comforting for people who is from Mexico, especially from Tijuana, to see this story, and that they have like these mixed feelings, but also they are like really mad and hurt about the story of the Arellano Felix and Chapo and all that, the narco marketing that is happening there. But you know, that's life. And I feel like narcos, they did such a good work on working with journalists from Tijuana and from whole Mexico to tell about the story, not to put the narco like a hero, you know, because here in Mexico, they do it too much. Like you can see another stories where you can see the narco never dies. They do like 5, 6, he has more lives than the cat. So, but in narcos, you can see the story and kind of like understood what happened in that specific time. And also what happened after, like, for example, no, the story of Pablo Escobar, we saw it in Narcos Colombia, like in the end, he died. Like
yeah.
they they do this like really hard work on the scripts, and they don't try to put the Narcos as a hero, which I really am really grateful to be in a show like that.
Yeah. You know what's wild is, and I don't even know how I got my hands on this book, but when I was 9 or 10, one of the first books that I read as a kid was Killing Pablo. And if I'm not mistaken, I think it's the book that's semi-based on kind of Narcos, the show. But that's how I first learned about Pablo Escobar, was reading that book. And it was from the perspective of the DEA agents. But it had all the photos. And, you know, that's when I first got introduced to Pablo Escobar when I was a kid. So when this Narcos show came out, I was like, man, I'm all over this. And it was amazing. And I was surprised. I was like, once Pablo died, how's the show gonna continue? And then Narcos Mexico comes out and it's just as good, and you guys do a phenomenal job. And, you know, I want there to be more. I hope there's gonna be more continuation. But one thing that I wanted to mention with your guys' family, you know, obviously, yeah, I mean, it's a drug dealing family. There's murder that takes place, but I really enjoyed the family scenes where, you know, you guys just got done, you know, killing somebody, but then you're sitting together eating cereal, watching TV, having dinner, and it was just a different perspective. I mean, what did you guys do to appear like you guys were so close? Like, was there any type of, did you guys have to hang out off set, or how does that work? It was so good.
It's so weird and magical. I mean, the thing is that I never worked with any of the actors that they play my family, and I knew them because some of them, like, they're really huge here in Mexico, and then they have done a lot of work in the industry. But for example, the one who plays Tigrillo, Jose Julian, he was in Society and he came directly from LA. So weird. I think that the cast directors, they did an amazing job. I don't know how come they made it, because in the moment that we were together, it was just magical. It was like we knew each other from another life. I don't know. But it was so easy to work with each one of the actors and with the sisters. And also I think that in specifically with the Arellano Felix, what the writers were looking for, it was to see how the family became an organization, and they worked, everyone had a specific thing to do. You can see in Edina, for example, that she's like this big boss, that she takes the lead on everything that is happening, not in the decisions, and also like this strong woman. And also our characters, I mean, the Arellanos Felix is so huge that you can do like in a spin-off. And we have so much characters that it was so hard, I think, for the writers to try to talk about each character, because each character we knew in our research that they had like a specific job in the way to work as an organization. And also like in the end, they treat them like brothers and sisters and they fight. And you can see that on scenes with Enedina and with the other two characters, that they play like this strong leads, but in the end, also it's interesting to put the women in front of a bigger organization, because I remember when I was in Tijuana, like I was, I don't know, like 9, 10, and when you were crossing the border from Tijuana to San Diego or San Isidro, I remember the billboards, like with the faces of the Arellano, but I never saw an Edina picture. Wow. You just saw like the male. Yeah. They were looking for the man. But there was no clue that an Edina was working and she was the lead. So it's really interesting that in the 80s, 90s, everyone were after the men. But no one thought that the women, they do like a really hard work on pushing the organization. And yes, as an actress, I'm really grateful that I had the chance to get to know the actors, but also to build this amazing family that, in the end of the show, everyone, we have like a specific chat where we can share messages, and we keep in touch because it was so magical for everyone.
And how long does it typically take to shoot a full season? It seems like these seasons just come out of nowhere. How long does it take to shoot a full season?
This specific season, because of the COVID and the lockdown, it took like almost more than a year. Like we start on March of 2020 and then we stop and we start shooting again in October. Then when we stop again, and then until the next March of 2021, we ended, we wrapped it because it was so hard. And even we thought that the project, it was going to stop, you know, because it was a really difficult time for everyone, but specifically for them as a production, because it was so expensive. And they were taking COVID tests like every 2 days to keep us like safe. And it took a lot of time. And I thought that it was going to be out, I don't know, next year, you know, yeah. But they did a lot of work. And it's so, for me to see the end product, like seeing it on Netflix and seeing the action scenes, it's so crazy because we were in the lockdown, you know? Yeah. And for example, the scene that I really love how they shoot it is the one in the airport where it's, they're trying to take Chapo, they're trying to kill him.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
That's a huge scene.
Yeah,
it's amazing, and you cannot imagine that they shoot it during the lockdown. So it's so crazy, but it took a lot of time. Like, for example, I think the second season it took like a year to shoot it and the post production and then release it. But this one it was like more than a year.
Yeah, do you guys shoot in Mexico or is it? Where do you guys typically shoot?
Yeah, we shoot in Mexico. Most of my scenes were in Mexico City. And it's so crazy because I didn't notice that they were this amazing scenarios. You know, that they found this kind of like 80s style houses. They were like mansions, like with glasses. And also we went to a ranch to shoot the scene of episode 10. But they traveled to Puerto Vallarta, I think so, and some areas around Mexico City. But yeah, I mean, it's amazing that you can find these places so close to Mexico City. And for them, like from season one and season two, they noticed that Mexico was so rich on this.
Yeah, and do you have the ability, like when you get the lines, do you have the ability to ad lib, or do the writers want you to say it exactly as it's written? Because sometimes when we see it on Netflix, sometimes the words are different from what the actor or actress is saying. Do you guys have the ability to ad lib, or do you have to say it exactly as it's written?
Well, as a family, or in my experience, we had so much. We were very open to just play around since we knew the character. For example, the scene that actually the episode where Wagner Moura direct us, he was like, you guys, you're a family, you're enjoying yourself. This is the happiest moment of the family. So just dancing. And for example, the line that I said, Viva Mexico, Viva Arriba Tijuana Cabrones.
Yep, I remember that.
It was like just me being myself, you know, like as a character.
And was it acting? No acting.
Like really natural. And Mora was like, yeah, say that again.
Did you get to meet, I'm also a huge fan of Jose Yaspic, who played Amado. Did you get a chance to meet with him at all? Or do you have any good stories from him? Because he was also in the original Narcos and they did a good job. I mean, he's looked the same because he had to look younger in the beginning of Narcos Mexico, and he just did an amazing job. Do you have any stories you could share from him?
No, unfortunately not, because since it was the lockdown, we were like, they were very careful to just put the actors that they need. Yeah. And I think he worked more with the character that he plays, Jessica, the Cuban girl from Cuba, Marta, and they went to the beach. So, but I know that he's from also from the north. I think he's actually from Tijuana too, and he did a great job. Like I told you, I'm very blessed that I had the chance to be in the same project as Jaspic or this actor Alberto Guerra, who played Maya Zambada, and Alfonso Dosal, who played my big brother, and all these big names around me, or being in the same show. It was amazing, and I'm really grateful. But no, I didn't have the chance to meet him.
So there's some rumors that there's going to be a spinoff. Is that, do you know anything about that, or is there any details about that you could?
I don't know anything. I know that they were like some rumors, yeah, about doing the season of El Chapo, and also it will be like very interesting because Alejo, the actor, he did a great job, yeah. And I know that he was very excited, like knowing that he was going to lead the next season, but at this moment, I just know that they ended and they wrapped it with Narcos and with the Arellano Felix. Like I told you, there's so much characters that you don't know, you don't have much time. You just have 10 episodes where you can get to know a little bit of each character and the most important part of the story of that character. But it will be amazing to see if they do El Chapo, because there's another Mexican series about El Chapo.
Yeah.
But it will be interesting to see how Netflix work with that story, since it's like he's the biggest, you know, it's after all that he went through. And you can see in Narcos Mexico, all the journey that this character has. It will be amazing to see how could be like his season on Netflix.
Yeah, what's amazing, what Narcos does really well, and they did this, you know, all the way back from the very first season, is they take small characters and introduce them in the previous season and then give them central focuses in the following seasons. Like El Chapo was just a small character in the first season, and then, you know, this last one, he was pretty much, you know, one of the main guys. So they're building I think they're building it to maybe doing a El Chapo season. Maybe they're waiting to see what really happens to him in real life too. But yeah, that would be phenomenal. No, excellent too. And just lastly also too, I always love asking the actors and the actresses whenever they're not working, what are some of the shows that you guys are binge watching? You guys are always busy, you guys are always working, but when you're home and relaxing, what are you watching TV show wise?
Well, the last one that I saw fully and I was obsessed, it was Squid Games, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it was so good. Like I think I didn't start like in the moment where everyone was like seeing it, but once I start, I ended like in one day.
Yeah.
It was so good. And also I love just seeing like European movies in another languages. The last movie that I saw actually yesterday is from a Mexican director. It's called, I think, Night of the Fire, something like that. It's totally like a Mexican theme from Tatiana Hueso. I love seeing independent movies. I just really enjoy more seeing movies sometimes or short series than seeing like a big, big series. I don't know, one of my favorites is Gone Girl. I'm obsessed with that movie. Or Closer, like it's more dramatic. But yeah, I tried my best because I think as an actress, it helped me a lot to keep like in touch and seeing what they're doing. Also Gentify, I have a friend that she was in the show in this last season. And I think like being aware of what they're doing, like in the in United States or in Europe or whatever, any part of the world, I love seeing what they're doing and what are also my possibilities to play or be in a show like that. Like I think right now the Latino market, it's like growing up so fast, and they having like they're making this more space for actors like from different nationalities, but specifically like the Latinos and Mexicans. So I would love to do something like that. So I'm just putting all my intentions there and also like being aware of what they're doing. And just, I love seeing movies and series.
Yeah, I mean, you found yourself on, you know, one of the hottest shows, you know, on TV, obviously on Netflix. I mean, Narcos is amazing. I mean, and you grew up, you know, being in Tijuana. How did you get into acting? Did you go to school in Tijuana? Did you go to school to get trained? Or how did you find yourself becoming an actress?
Well, since I was young, I was doing stuff in a scenario. Like I did gymnastics. I went to musical, like classic musical classes. Also, I play violin. But no one in my family was like really into art. Like they sang and play like guitar and piano, but just for fun. But no one was like really good into like putting like as a career, you know, like in arts. So I was the first one. I actually study, I have a degree in communications and I did it in, I got my degree on the, like the local university in Tijuana. And also there I took more classes for my musical training and I started like going to acting classes, but I didn't like really took it like that seriously. I thought that I was like, just playing. And then after I got my degree, I decided to just move to Mexico City and see, like try to build like my journey on acting. But since my background was being like a TV host, it was kind of like difficult because I got these gigs on TV. And also I wanted to study and prepare more as an actress. So in one point I just decided just to drop off like this, like my incomes as a TV host and just put in all my energy. And well, in the end it worked, thank God.
Is Mexico City the hub? Like if you're doing, you know, Latin movies or shows, is that the Hollywood? Is that the hub in Mexico or are there different parts?
No, Mexico City is huge. Like 10 years ago that I came, it was so huge and it feels not like, like for example, the Romanovs came and shoot an episode here and a lot of big productions come and they shoot here in Mexico City. If you made it in Mexico City, you can made it everywhere because it's so hard. Like we have like an industry, but not in like an industry like in Hollywood, but it could be like the Latin Hollywood. And but now they're doing so much stuff and I'm so happy that they trying to move like the industry to cities near to Mexico City, like Guadalajara or Monterrey, or also Tijuana that they shoot. For example, in Tijuana, they shoot Fear the Walking Dead. And also they did Coyote, which is like for NBC, I think. Yeah, and sure. They're doing a lot of stuff now there in Tijuana. So like the market is opening and most of the America shows, they come to Mexico or just being in Tijuana or Mexico City. But now like it's more open and after COVID, you can just send a self-tape and be in a show in Canada or wherever the work takes.
Yeah. And, you know, being now that you're in Mexico City, you know, what are some fun things? What do you do in your spare time when you're not working? What keeps you busy?
Seeing movies. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I keep like doing castings. I also write. I'm trying to produce my own stuff. I did a comedy short film like years ago. And now I'm trying to just write two series that I want to produce and also act. And trying to keep like my creativity, like everywhere that I can do it. I also, sometimes I assist edition. So for me as an actress, like everything that it comes like about movies or series or whatever I can learn as an actress, I try to put all my time there. I also read a lot and yeah, I just go to the gym, you know, and also like trying to live like a normal life, like doing laundry or whatever, like going to a park and having a coffee and I love going to parks. For example, for me as an actress, one of my big for me as work, I love going to the park, having a coffee and looking at people. Like kind of sounds like we are like
I do the same thing. I do the same thing. It's the best.
But it works. Like for me as an actor, you can see how people act like in real life. And that's a really good material. So I try to do everything that I do. It's about my craft, and I have to use it, you know, every time, anything.
Well, if you ever, you know, on your next project that you make, if you need an extra, I'm ready to go.
Let's do it.
Let me know. And just lastly, you know, are you able to share any of your upcoming projects or anything that we could see you in coming up or that you're working on now?
Well, actually, I did something for local television. Like, it's a horror story. So I'm really excited to see when it's released. I think it's going to be released next year. And also, I wrap another project where I play a tattoo artist. It's so fun because after Narcos, I'm really open to just play whatever they give me, you know, like experience and give life to these characters that can be like really interesting. And now like I'm working on a project that it's about like the violence against women. That is really like a very hard topic here in Mexico. And I mean, around the world, but like after the Me Too movement, a lot of shows came with that idea. But you cannot see that much in Mexico City. So right now, I was in the meeting like an hour ago, and we're going to start like working on that project. And I'm really excited because it's about a lawyer who tries to protect like people who is in and prostitution and like human traffic and all that. So it's totally different what I did in my last three projects, and I'm really excited. So we'll see. Hopefully it's gonna be out next year and we're gonna start working on it.
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, once these projects come out next year, we'll use that as an excuse to bring you back for—
Exactly.
For— And no, definitely sounds like a passion project, and I'm excited to that you're keeping busy and that we can see some of your work in the coming year. And again, I still can't believe I was watching you a couple of days ago and now we're on the show. So I just want to, again, Marilyn, thank you very much for joining. It's an honor to have you on. This has been an amazing show, and just get to kind of pick your brain and kind of learn what your experience was like. And yeah, definitely looking forward to keeping in touch, and hopefully we can bring you back sometime soon.
No, thank you so much for this interview. I mean, like this talk, I love it. And we're going to keep in touch for the next projects.
I really appreciate it. Thank you very much, and enjoy your evening, and take care. We'll talk soon.
Thank you.